Hey everybody, and welcome to the WWE Royal Rumble 2016 pay-per-view review on EM Ultra Uprising. I am your host, EM Ultra. Thank you for joining me here today on the show. First and foremost, before I begin the actual review of the show, I do want to take this moment to announce the winner of my 2016 Royal Rumble contest, and that is none other than Jaszmine Robinson, who entered in at the number 30 spot when I did my drawing back last week. So the first contest winner is Jaszmine Robinson. You, Jaszmine, will get an opportunity to be a part of the show the week before WrestleMania, assuming that that is going to work with you. So I look forward to having you on the show, and we'll be in touch in the meantime. Looking forward to having a guest host, and do not forget that I will be doing a lot more contests going forward. So thank you to everybody who did go ahead and participate. It was a really fun thing to do, and I was really glad to be able to have a contest on the channel. I really appreciate everybody who took the time, and I look forward to announcing another contest probably in a few weeks. Anyway, if you have any questions for my Q&A that you'd like to ask, be sure to do so. That's going live later this week. More than likely, we're looking at Thursday, the 28th of January. So keep that date in mind, but I will be back with a Raw review where I'll let you know for sure where that's going to be. Also, be sure to follow me on Twitter and check out PWF Empire Live. That's really all the only other things I can ask of you guys. I've wasted enough of your time with this talk, and I think it's time we go ahead and review the Royal Rumble. How about that? So, first and foremost, we had a last man standing match for the Intercontinental Championship. Dean Ambrose retaining the championship over Kevin Owens in a great opening contest. I honestly could not ask for a better way to start off the night than this last man standing match. I remember in my preview video saying that I honestly thought that it might be the tag title match, which could have been a suitable opener, but I think this one was even better. It gets the crowd hyped, gives us some awesome spots also in the meantime, especially when Owens went through those two tables to finish the match. But there were some good spots in between here as well, involving tables, involving chairs, involving announce tables, involving everything. So these two guys just tore each other apart. It felt like a legit last man standing match. Those guys were really fighting for something. They were fighting for that championship. They were fighting against each other. They didn't like one another. And you could tell the way that this match was booked that that's how it was. It felt like a personal rivalry and something that was really coming to a head here at Royal Rumble over the Intercontinental Championship. Not only do I think this has been one of the more unique and decent Intercontinental Championship feuds in quite some time, I have to be honest and tell you that I thought that the payoff was just as good as you could have asked for. To be honest, probably even better. This is a 4 out of 5 for me. A great, great way to kick off the night. And honestly, Ambrose retaining was a bit of a surprise. I actually thought Owens was going to take the championship back, but I had no problem with it because, let's be honest here, either guy with the title is a good thing. And Ambrose hanging on to it, to me, doesn't do anything but help him to continue to get more and more legitimate. So that's a good sign, and it was a great way to kick off the night. Now we have the Tag Team Championship next. New Day retaining over the Usos before the match. New Day coming down with Francesca 2, the sequel to the original Francesca. And as soon as I saw that, I knew that my prediction that the Usos were going to take the championships was probably going to be incorrect. Although they did really give us a big swerve, a big false finish in this match, where it looked like the Usos all but had the titles won and ultimately did not with a quick rope break, courtesy of Xavier Woods on the outside. And not only that, but this match was really good too. I mean, you have a great opening last man standing match, and then you have a great tag title match to follow it up. I mean, you really can't get a better opening to a pay-per-view than this. And really what I like so much here is that this match came in the dreaded 2 spot. I always talk about the dreaded 2 spot because you have a great opener sometimes on pay-per-views, and then the second match, everyone kind of falls asleep on because it's either not hardcore or there's, you know, nothing really to it, or it's a boring match or whatever. But this is a tag title match that honestly is good anyway, and you knew it would be. But it's also different from the opener. And because it was different from the opener, you could definitely still get into this match. And that's, I think, what really helped here. New Day retained the titles. I'm absolutely fine with that. The catch from Big E at the end was really well executed. Really good way to end this match, to be completely honest. But overall, I gotta say, this is worth 3.5 stars out of 5 for me. Really solid tag title match to follow up. A really great last man standing match. So far, so good for the Royal Rumble 2016. We move on to the United States Championship, where Kalisto wins the championship from Del Rio. Now, this is one spot where I thought it was almost for sure the champion would retain, and I was wrong again. So I was wrong on all three of the first three matches, and I'm absolutely okay with that because of unpredictability, it made me say, oh, wow, I didn't see that coming a lot of times early in the show. And there was a lot of false finishes, especially in those first two matches, where you weren't even sure who was going to win anyway. That's pretty exciting. Anyway, the United States Championship match was pretty botchy. It really wasn't anywhere near as good as the first two. And Alberto Del Rio always wrestles like he's possessed when it's against a luchador. I don't know what it is that he has against masked wrestlers, but he always tries to either A, pull the mask off, B, be too aggressive, and C, he gets sloppy. And it makes the entire match sloppy from beginning to end. And I think that was really evident here. There was a lot of botchiness. There was a lot of miscommunication. It certainly looked that way, at least. And, I mean, it wasn't a completely trashy match, and I'm not sitting here telling you that it was completely bad, but it certainly didn't live up to all the other matches from this night, let's be honest. This was definitely the weakest match of the five, and Kalisto winning the championship was a nice moment. It would have been a lot nicer if he hadn't already won the title on Raw a couple of weeks ago, only to lose it back a couple nights later to Del Rio, and now wins it back here at Rumble. Again, hot potatoing where I don't think it was necessary. I think they could have just had Kalisto come close and so close and so close, and then his final opportunity was here at the Royal Rumble. It was a last chance opportunity for Kalisto, and he finally gets the job done. He wins the title. He gets a big four pay-per-view moment, and it wasn't as much of that moment, even though we still did get a moment out of it. So I'm not shitting on it. I'm just saying I think the execution could have been better, and not only that, but this was not their best match. That match they had on Raw a couple weeks ago was better than this one, in my opinion. So this gets 2.5 out of 5, 2.5 stars out of 5. It was all right. The moment at the end was okay, and again, I'm not going to sit here and tell you the whole match was bad, because it wasn't all bad, but there was enough botches throughout it that it kept it from being a pretty damn good match. Anyway, Divas Championship, Charlotte retaining over Becky Lynch with the help of her daddy, Ric Flair, throwing the jacket, his suit jacket, over the head of Becky Lynch when it looked like she was all but had the championship won. Again, him playing a role in Charlotte's matches has been a good thing. It's actually helped Charlotte develop so much better as a heel, and not only that, but she's in the right role. Her robotic baby face that was, like, emotionless was fucking terrible, and it was not necessary at all. It was honestly an awful character direction for Charlotte to be in. This is so much better, and she's the pampered little princess, and they're using Ric Flair effectively as her manager. Not only is it enhancing her, but him being there, it doesn't feel like they're just shoving it down your throat that he's her dad. They're now making him a part of the package, and that works, whereas before they just kept mentioning it and mentioning it with no real reason to mention it. Anyway, this was a good match. Really, really good stuff. And the feud has been built up really well. Honestly, Divas feuds are usually not all that well built. This was certainly an exception to the rule because I think these two have really been booked well individually. Becky Lynch especially as a heroine and Charlotte as the heel pampered princess. So they've done a really good job building this feud and making it feel like there was something personal between the two considering that they used to be friends and whatnot. So it all came to a head here, and it was good. And Becky, they teased Becky winning the championship at multiple moments, but ultimately Charlotte still gets away with the heelish win. And then afterwards, you get the best moment of them all. My personal favorite diva, Sasha Banks, comes out and kicks ass. She kicks Becky Lynch's ass and then kicks Charlotte's ass after faking her out, making it look like she was going to be aligned with her. She said, "No, oh, way, bitch. I want that championship for myself." And so that was an awesome moment. I hope this leads to a triple threat going forward. If it doesn't, it's just a singles match between Charlotte and Sasha. I'm all right with it, but I want Becky Lynch to stay relevant because she is really good, and she has proven that in the last few weeks. People are behind her gimmick. I just hope WWE can actually get behind her too. That's one of those things where you say, hey, we all as fans like her a lot. I don't know if WWE feels the same way, but we sure as hell do. Either way, this was a really good Divas Championship match with some good reversals, good transitions in this match. I liked the momentum, the pacing. It was right on point to where it needed to be, and honestly, it delivered. And then to have Sasha come out afterwards just leads you to be excited for what goes forward in the Divas Championship picture. It's a very rare sight, but right now, main roster Divas are looking good. And it's all because of the fact that they were so damn good in NXT, but they weren't used well on the main roster, and that's where the complaints were coming in. Now you have them being used much better. 3.5 stars out of 5 for the whole thing. Let's move on. Royal Rumble 2016. It's about that time that we talk about the big match itself. And the game, being the man, coming in at number 30 and winning the Royal Rumble, last eliminating Dean Ambrose, which is a weird thing to say because you would have thought I would have said Roman Reigns. He did eliminate Roman Reigns right before he eliminated Dean Ambrose. But the last two were Ambrose and Triple H. Now let's highlight this match. First of all, you have Roman Reigns out one, and number two is Rusev. So last year, you had Rusev, the last guy eliminated by Roman Reigns. This time, he was the first guy eliminated by Roman Reigns. Okay, whatever. I guess it makes a little bit of sense in terms of it being the League of Nations, but nobody really thinks about them because they're an irrelevant stable, let's be honest. Anyway, moving forward, A fucking J fucking Styles fuck was number three. And all those fucks are necessary because it's an amazing moment when you see the phenomenal one, the best wrestler in the world, in my personal opinion, finally in a WWE ring. And let me tell you something, even though I had it spoiled for me prior to by, Bleacher Report or whatever, even though I had it spoiled to me and it was basically already confirmed that he was going to be in the Rumble, it was still a really exciting moment. The crowd popped like crazy. It sent shivers right down my fucking spine. It was an amazing moment, and I was really happy. It's just so cool to finally see this guy in WWE after all these years, after all the time of saying, man, can you imagine if AJ Styles was ever in WWE wrestling? You know, because he was such a huge name for TNA, such a huge name in Japan, such a huge name globally. You know what? He deserves it. He deserves to have the exposure. I'm not sure how well he'll be used or featured or anything like that. But he deserves the feature. He deserves to be put on a platform of this level. Everyone deserves to know the name of AJ Styles. And he performed well. He got a good showing. He got thrown out by Kevin Owens. And that's fine because, honestly, I'd love to see him and Owens. But there's a bigger story with Owens, and I'll get there in a second. Either way, he was featured well. We got to see what he could do. You know, anybody who doesn't know him, and everybody who does know him gets to see what he does and just be, you know, reminisce with everything that he can do. If you haven't watched him since TNA, and if you haven't, you really missed out because some of his New Japan matches have been excellent. But anyway, his appearance was fucking awesome. You move forward through the Rumble. Sami Zayn makes his return, and him and Owens start brawling. That was fucking amazing. That was a great moment. Another moment in there that was fun. R-Truth comes out, throws a ladder into the ring, climbs up, and thinks it's Money in the Bank. Now, see, this is where the comedic pieces to the Royal Rumble puzzle can be a really good fucking thing. I really liked that moment. It was funny. It made me laugh out loud. And I enjoyed it, you know? And Roman Reigns at one point gets incapacitated by the League of Nations, and then, you know, gets almost stretchered out or whatever, and then comes back. Like, you knew that was all gonna happen once he got beat down. My only gripe with that is the fact that why would the League of Nations not be smarter and drag him over the top rope so he would be eliminated, right? Again, it's one of those because wrestling moments, and it's really annoying. I don't like that. I don't like that it's unexplainable. That doesn't make any fucking sense. Another thing, Kofi Kingston's save moment this year wasn't anywhere near as effective as most of his other ones. I guess last year he went into the Rosebuds. That's even worse. But this one wasn't all that great either. I mean, he was on the shoulders of Big E, which was cool because it was involvement of the New Day. But I don't know. I liked when he was doing handstands and jumping around in a fucking chair a little more than I enjoyed this. But it was a little bit underwhelming. Another thing that I found to be a little bit of a gripe might have been Chris Jericho, how long he lasted in the match. I kept forgetting he was in there, and then I was just like, why is he still there? Another thing that's more important, I'm not really going to complain about Jericho being in there for a long time. I'm a big Chris Jericho fan, but he just doesn't feel like he fits into the story and the direction that WWE is going in right now, that the wrestling company is in. He just doesn't seem like he fits in that puzzle. It's nothing against him personally. I really like Chris Jericho. I'm a big fan. But I don't know, this current return that he was on didn't really feel connected. Maybe that's because the last time we saw him, he was a heel and turned on Ambrose and Reigns. So why wouldn't he go after maybe Ambrose? Maybe they'll still visit that. I hope they do. But we didn't really get to see any of that here. Anyway, another thing was Brock Lesnar getting eliminated by the Wyatt family. I am okay with Brock Lesnar versus Bray Wyatt in terms of the story they can tell with it, but it seems all but obvious that Brock Lesnar would beat Bray Wyatt at WrestleMania, and that would be that. I feel like they're painting themselves into another Bray Wyatt loses, okay, there's nothing relevant about these guys once again type of corners. They're painting themselves into that corner again. And I feel it. I feel it with this feud. It's not going to do anything if Bray Wyatt doesn't win. He has to actually live up to his hype sometimes. He has to win some matches. He doesn't have to win them all. And I know some people have said that in the past. Well, hey, man, you know, they don't have to win them all. And I agree. They don't have to win them all. But they have to win some, and they don't win any. They don't win any of the major feuds. Not against Cena, not against Taker or Kane. You know, none of them. None of the major feuds that they've even been a part of have they won. And I feel like Brock Lesnar is just on the same story. Wyatt, Lesnar, it's a weird story. Nobody's really a hero there because Lesnar's just a badass. So it's a little bit of a strange story. We'll see where they go with it. I'm not going to jump the gun. I wish Lesnar was in the match a little longer, and I don't feel like he got the proper feature that he should have gotten here in this Royal Rumble. So that was a gripe. This wasn't a perfect Rumble by any stretch of the imagination, but Triple H coming in at number 30 and winning was pretty fucking awesome. I'm really happy about this because I love the idea of the personal and deep and gritted rivalry that we can get between Roman Reigns and Triple H going into WrestleMania. I'm hoping for an Orton-Triple H-esque type of feud, except Triple H is the heel this time instead of the face. I want to see this be a personal, you know, knock-em-out, grind-out type of, like, rough-and-tumble feud. And I hope they kick that right off here on the first Raw. And I know by the time a lot of you guys will watch this, by the time this might even be uploaded, it'll be during or after Raw is over, because I'm not recording this until Monday. But, you know, I'm hoping that this feud gets good, consistent build, and we get a really good WrestleMania match out of the two. Either way, this was a very good Royal Rumble, some really good moments. Again, not perfect. There were some gripes that I had. But AJ Styles featured well. Sami Zayn's return was fucking awesome. I hope that him and Owens are going to have a match at WrestleMania. R-Truth's moment was funny, and it was enjoyable. Roman Reigns did have a good showing, I felt, in this match. The League of Nations thing was kind of pointless. It just didn't really make a whole lot of fucking sense. But Triple H's return, simply amazing. I did not expect Ambrose to be the last guy that he would eliminate. It was kind of a nice little bit of a twist. Another thing I would have liked to have seen would have been for Roman Reigns to attack Triple H afterwards, because by the time Triple H eliminates Dean Ambrose, Reigns would have had the wherewithal to get back in that ring. Maybe not, but I think that would have made a nice little finish. It would have been Triple H celebrating Reigns with a spear and holds up the championship. Maybe that makes him look too much like a heel, and maybe that's why they didn't explore that avenue. They didn't want to make Reigns look like a heel and look like a bitch every time he loses, getting mad. But yeah, see, that's where if they want, because I know WWE's dead set on making him a babyface. Now, I am all for the idea of Reigns either being a tweener, a heel, whatever, because when Seth Rollins comes back, assuming Reigns is the champion at that time, Seth Rollins is going to be a babyface. Whether he's booked the same way he was before or not, he's going to be a babyface. You know why? Because everyone loves Seth Rollins, and it's going to be a long time coming to see him come back. Everyone's going to pop when he comes back. So he's going to be a babyface by default, and I think they should run with that and have Roman Reigns be more of a heel-esque type of character. Be jealous of the fact that Rollins is still more popular than him, even though he's been, you know, waving the flag of WWE. You know, he's been the one who's been leading the charge for WWE for all these months while you've been injured, and yet you still are more popular than me. You still are getting the cheers that I never got. That could be a fucking awesome story. And there's so much history with those two guys. Throw Ambrose in there and you got a fucking amazing triple threat championship feud that could be one of the best in years. So, again, Roman Reigns not being a face isn't a bad thing. I know WWE's dead set on it, so that's okay. And Triple H versus Roman Reigns at WrestleMania, I've wanted to see Triple H versus Roman Reigns since 2012. So I'm fucking excited for that match, and I know it could be a great one. Triple H, your World Heavyweight Champion, a great finish to a great night. 4 stars for the Royal Rumble, 8 out of 10 for me for the whole night. This was a great Royal Rumble pay-per-view, and maybe not everybody felt the same way, that's alright, but for me personally, this was a great show that was a huge step up from the last two, and a hugely great show, especially when you consider the build-up for this show. So that just about does it, guys. So I hope you guys enjoyed the review very much, and I can't wait to be back with you for the Raw review. Thanks, as always, for taking the time to watch. Be sure to give me that thumbs up if you enjoyed. Comment your own thoughts on the Rumble down below, and subscribe for plenty more to come. So, like I said, be back with you for a Raw review. A couple other videos coming out during the week. including the Q&A, and finally, the Ultra Report that I've referenced multiple times, that new series that I've wanted to start up for you guys, will be out before the end of the month as well, so I can't wait to get things going as the channel continues to grow. That is going to do it for me, so I hope you guys enjoyed the Rumble, and I look forward to hearing from you guys in the comments down below, and until next time, Ultra out.